Welcome everybody here to your BenQ Dota 2 Clash. It is your weekend tournament of 500 euro winner takes all, sponsored by the lovely people of BenQ. We have ourselves a semi-finals, our second one. We've already had our first one where Monkey went through very, very convincingly 2-0 up against Panzer. We now have EZ, the guys who did not drop a single game, the only team in the competition so far to not drop a single game. They'll be going up against DTS. DTS, the guys who found themselves in a three-way time lock of, points lock of 2-1 win. So two wins, one loss. How's the end of Group B? But they did get through due to the time rating. So they actually won their games fast enough to actually get themselves through into the next round. And of course, what awaits for them is EZ. Will they be able to get through? We are about to find out. We jump ourselves now into the game. We'll also give some voice to lovely people who made the sound bites for all the heroes here. So as far as our bands go, let's see how we do actually roll. Let me just see just how much 1437, the guy who was actually being the captain for EZ, he's been doing it all the time. 1437 being the support hit player, actually being the captain, or at least the drafter for EZ. She's still uncertain who the captain actually is for that team. It's actually 1437, if it's Lacoste, PowerNet, Infinity, Universe. Could be any of them. Maybe it's just a team. We're gonna class them as a team. Reserve time. And yes, by the way, for all those people that she just said, oh, I said actually, I did that on purpose for you just then. I actually did. Yeah, I've discussed that in the previous cast. Anyway, let's have a look at our bans at the moment. Slaughter and Nice Lock are taken down, so really wanting to remove out the Russian's aggressiveness. Slaughter, fantastic hero, maybe makes me think that he's being taken out. I thought this last time Slaughter was actually taken out. I thought, okay, Slaughter's out. We might get to see Stealth Assassin. It might be amazing. It might be in it. And for the first time, we get to see him casted here in the tournament. At which point, we saw nothing along those lines. So it's just like, thanks, guys. Great. Didn't even look at that. Broodmother now being banned out. So fair enough, Ben, as well, seeing Broodmother being removed out. With Slaughter being picked up, if you cast, obviously, Amplify Damage on Broodmother, she gets revealed completely. It's just like, oh, hang on. So a smart ban out there by Priceless, who is actually... He is actually Funnick, so it actually is Funnick. There's also Crunch down there in the fifth slot. He changed his name to something retarded. The players got really, really bored, so they thought they'd just actually modify the names. So Thon Mayo, the Honey Badger, who was trying to actually convince me that he was somebody, he actually was art styles, but it's not actually true. It's Socks, plural Socks. And then we have Cliff, who also takes up our lineup. So not every one of that team is actually from DTS. They're using a couple of substitutions from Virus and SGC. But that's what we kind of like live with. So, Prophet comes up. Obviously, with Broodmother being banned, with Slaughter being added into it, the normal bans being Nightstalker in some form of carry, this time Anti-Mage, Broodmother and some form of Ganker, this time Slaughter, leads Prophet into the mix for what he actually wants to do. So he can be pushing, he can do whatever he wants to do. Second pick comes up. Tidehunter once again coming up into the lineup. He should get farm. I'm interested to see just how they play Prophet again. Do we see Prophet on the top lane? Because that was something which we saw in our last game when Prophet was picked up in the for the Dire side. And he ended up just actually going into the lane on top. We saw a very, very early TP, took the wards and actually jumped down bottom to actually stop the creep camp so he couldn't pull anything. And also keep that vision for where they're moving around. If you need a gank, he'll be there for it. And not actually going this in a neutral Prophet, which we have always seen during the International. But it's kind of like... rotated the way Prophet's being played. Do we actually now go in the neutrals? Do we go in towards the lane? Do we try and actually be nothing but a ganker? And that's kind of the role which Prophet's kind of gone into, but even then it was kind of like this weedy kind of version that Link was playing, where it was, I have a TP for ganking, but I've also got one level on Sprout so I can farm. I'm one level on Treant so I can actually farm, and there was actually no Sprout, so it's kind of like, what the hell? My brain is kind of starting to hurt. Windrunner and Void now coming up, so a big, big hard carry. Really hard to have anyone to go up against. Void and Windrunner also in the mix. Not a bad hero to pick up. The power shot will destroy that sprout of the tree. So if Faces Void does get caught, or she gets caught herself, she can either Windrun or also power shot. Lich being in the mix makes me actually wonder a little bit more about this, though. Like, do we see Lich go up in solo top, or do we see Windrunner actually help there? Or do we actually see both? We have seen like the kind of whole thing of like, let's just leave a solo lane to its own devices, kind of disappear. It's not the normal thing where we just see a standard tri lane, solo mid, solo top. We're seeing two appearing in mid, or we see one hero on top who's getting the farm and just one hero babysitting like an Earthshaker or something on those lines. So I'm not saying the days of the tri-lane are actually over, but I'm saying the days of the tri-lane are kind of like modifying themselves into this weird kind of like mix-up where you don't, where you can't just say instantly, tri-lane, guarantee you, tri-lane, it'll be legend support, it'll be faces void farming, it'll be Windrunner just there pulling on the side as well as giving you a couple of shackles and power shots. I can't really say that. Because, yeah, that's not really true yet. So we'll give it some time. We'll give it some time. I'm interested to see how SMM will also modify our current metagame or the way we actually look at it, with hopefully a couple of European teams going to attend SMM. I will be there live on the joinDOTA stream. It will be this stream, the one you're currently tuning into, where you can actually watch Witch all your Doctor. SMM coverage. Witch Doctor? Okay, first time for today. He was picked up two times yesterday. Not a bad hero to actually go if you do actually need that bounce stun. Really makes it great for initiation, especially when you catch two heroes by themselves. And then it makes it awesome. Like, it's not as great as, like, the Faces Void ultimate and then the Lich ultimate bouncing around inside. Not as awesome as that. But Witch Doctor can be a massive pain in the ass, especially with that Maledict. And they will actually need that, too, if they want to bring down the Faces Void. They need that initial stun to actually happen. Then the Maledict on top of the Void, hold him in place, let the Witch Doctor only hit a couple of times, and then you will bring down the Faceless Void. Because you don't always get to hit him. The backtrack will actually kind of, like, negate that in a couple, a fair amount of a lot of the damage you actually do. But with a Maledict on top, the damage you do does get actually replicated on again. So it kind of works out nicely. Ancient Apparition and Spectre now being banned out. Not a bad thing taking out Spectre. They're taking out any hero which can basically stand up against the Void. We did see Spectre in our last game get massively, massively powerful. It was really, really hard to actually even initiate on him at all. So Spectre taken out. More than likely we might see Dro Ranger. Either picked or banned during this, because we still need to actually have the Dire pick up their big agi carry as well. They need the damage dealer, and they will need a pure damage dealer. I don't want to see these lines of like, oh, we can get it with a Ravage, probably gonna do a little bit of damage, which not demanding, it'll do the job. No, you need an agi hero, be it Dwarven Sniper, be it Dro Ranger, be it any freaking person you actually want. Just get yourself an agi damaging hero. Preferably one for range, so Mirana would even do the job, but probably not as much as you need to for the Faceless Void. It needs to be more damage than what Mirana can deal out, especially if Mirana goes for a Lincoln Sphere build. Makes it massively, massively, massively defensive. And I kind of sit there just going, wow, okay, great. You went Lincolns. Well, you could have gone Yasha. You could have gone Manta. Could have even gone a freaking Desolator if you wanted to. That would have actually done a great job. Butterfly. Get a Butterfly, mate. Butterfly. But yeah, not going to work out for them. Actually, some guy actually recommending Pudge. Pudge actually wouldn't be a bad pickup for, I'm going to say, the Radiant at this point, actually. Pudge would actually be a pretty awesome pickup as far as, like, just initiating, grabbing the Witch Doctor out, grabbing even a Prophet, and you still don't know what Agi carries are going to be coming up. And they can run that as a mid-solo, depending how it's going to go. Like, we've got two support heroes at the moment. Razor actually being banned out now, too. Weird to see Razor being banned out. This isn't the first time Easy have actually done this. Now, Razor hasn't appeared a single time in the entire competition. But Razor has, apart from in a ban stage, and Easy was the only other team to actually do it so far in this competition, and now they banned him out a second time. So they either just fear the tank ability of Razor, and he can get pretty tanky, but to the point of actually being able to stand toe-on-toe with Faceless Void, it doesn't really get there. It's just that static around him that causes trouble for Faceless Void. And I think that's the only reason why we see Easy actually ban it out. Vengeful Spirit and Ancient Apparition being our last bands out from the Dire. Just removing out their support, which might make me think there might be an Enigma coming along the ways. Beastmaster, well, there goes Enigma. You ain't going to pick Enigma while Beastmaster's there. Now that I've said that, they're going to do it. Always happens. Always happens. The Beastmaster will now come in towards the mix. They'll probably cap it off with a easy support here, so maybe something like an Earthshaker. Wouldn't be a bad pick considering he's going up against Prophet as well. Just get yourself a big, big ES ulti, big fat ES ulti, and now basically demolish off all the life points of the Witch Doctor, as well as the Prophet. Prophet is actually still pretty squishy, man. Like, he's everywhere, he always has himself an army, but you throw yourself down a good ES, and, well, life looks hunky-dory after that point. But the Dire at this point, they do need some initiation. It can come from the Prophet. Initiation can come from the Prophet, but it's not always great positional play to actually do it with him. So they do need a better hero for that. Spectre would have actually done the job pretty nicely, considering she just haunt in. So it's like, oh my god, I'm being attacked by however many people. Weaver comes up. So there's our the agi damage we're looking for. I don't know if it's going to be enough to kill off the Void. It's going to be one hell of a farmed Weaver if it's actually going to stop the Void. The only upside for the Weaver is if Void doesn't actually keep the time lock on the Weaver, then Weaver will be able to escape. But the downside is Mask of Madness up on the Void. You're guaranteed basically a perma stun. You'll never be able to actually move.
10 seconds.
So one more pickup for the Radiant. They're probably just thinking who we want right now. One more pickup is all they can afford. And it's going to be, well, it could actually be, it might not even be a support hero. I actually want to see Lina or SK. I kind of want to go for SK. SK would be pretty awesome. And that'll give him a lot of team fight potential as well. Massive team fight potential, actually, if they pick up an SK. Yeah. People are actually recommending Lion as well. Lion wouldn't be a bad pick, especially when you're trying to shut down the Weaver. Especially if you actually get Lion level up a lot. It was actually something done in a previous match. I can't remember what match it was that we actually played. But it was during this competition. And Lion was actually solo on the top lane up against a Weaver. And it was just harassment, harassment, harassment. And then just burst him down with a finger. It was just like, well, we're waiting. We were all waiting for the ultimate. And there's that Earthshaker anyway. So I can actually stop going, oh, I think it's going to be him. But Earthshaker's now into all of the mixed. There's your Pudge. You get your wish, IRC! The punch is there. Well, if you want to join the guys in IRC, QuakeNet, hashtag joinDOTA. You can join them there. But yes, we actually have ourselves our Pudge. Considering there's Beastmaster in the mix too, they could easily do that. So Pudge will be going in towards our middle lane. Weaver will be supported on the top lane by Witch Doctor, as well as Tidehunter, which will leave Prophet Solo bottom? Possibility, and probably more than likely. As far as the Radiant actually go, Windrunner should be solo top. We'll have Lich and Earthshaker. Lich more than likely will be supporting up the middle lane, and that's probably also something which might be happening with Witch Doctor. Might join the Pudge in the middle lane, but I actually prefer him not to do that. Just let the Pudge stand on his own ground, get those early levels up against the Beastmaster, and then rotate around and actually help him out. But let him get those early levels. He needs those early levels to increase the range of the hooks. I'm guessing somebody wants to plan a war there. If you weren't looking, look at the minimap. All right, so all five now going down towards the Adaya bottom lane. That's five from the Radiant. Let's check out who's playing what. So PowerNet playing as the Beastmaster once again. Infinity playing Windrunner, 14370. Does amazing Earthshaker work. Lacoste playing the hard carry as the Faceless Void. And it leaves Universe playing our last support hero, the Lich. In the meantime, Weaver will be priceless. As I've mentioned before, that is Funic. We have Thon Mayo, he'll be playing as the Witch Doctor. So that should be our bottom lane with Weaver. Will be a tri lane with Cliff supporting as the Tidehunter. Mid lane solo will be Pudge, that is Krennic. You're going to read through the frickin' things. And Honey Badger Shakar will be playing Prophet. So it looks like he'll be solo top lane. Not a bad choice to actually do, considering you can actually, if your micro is good enough, you can actually use the Nature's Call, use the Treants, and you can actually pull your own wave. So just basically pull up between here. Makes life hunky-dory. Windrunner's down the bottom lane. Earthshaker's here. So looks like we actually go a bit of a change-up. So yeah, there's our Lich with Lacoste. Not surprising. So Lich to help out Lacoste in the middle lane. It's going to be a little bit of harassment for Pudge. He's not going to care too much. Actually, got level 1 on Rot, surprisingly. Like, it can help you out a little bit if you get close enough. If Lacoste decides to dump, then you just basically throw the Rot down. We'll slow Lacoste down. But Pudge knows he can't get in close. He fears that gank from behind as well. Knowing that there could be an Earthshaker fissure. Until Earthshaker shows himself, which he has now done. Thon Mayo has now seen him, so Pudge might feel a little bit more aggressive on that bottom lane. Already the creep wave being denied up in that middle. It's going to make life very, very difficult. Not to mention difficult on the bottom lane. If a bouncing cask actually hits there on Windrunner, it's going to give more than enough time for a Gush as well as a Weaver attack. He can shook it to get himself in a good position to keep that attack going. And there goes that Shookie, just simple harassment on Infinity. Can run in, run back. Very, very easy life. We shot to now leaving that bottom lane just to help out the Pudge in the middle. More than likely, if we actually check out already throwing a stun. Wow, man. Use that mana. But already I want to check out the CS scores between Pudge as well as Lacoste. So Lacoste at 6-1, Pudge at 1-0, and that's the reason why Thon Mayo is now here in the middle lane. They need that farm to actually happen on Pudge so we can get towards those earn charges. Then he can roam, then he can gank, then freedom is his. Beastmaster on Prof on the top lane. That's a really hard lane for Beastmaster. Really, really hard lane. Having to deal with that range harassment. And Prof able to actually create up a creep wave whenever he wants to. He actually hasn't done that though. He's on two levels on TP, one level on Sprout. That's fair enough for him as well. All he really needs to do is harass. Surprisingly, actually don't even see one level on stats. That might come for the next one. Already forced to pop off a Sour from the middle lane to help Pudge stay alive. Lacoste can just tank up anything, any form of harassment the Wish Doctor does. There's always that backtrack chance, which he already has at level 1. The only downside for Lacoste is he's having to split his XP. So Wish Doctor rotates up and picks up an invis rune.
Invisibility.
Well, that actually just make Lacoste feel a little bit unsafer. Cliff really staying in the front line. It's just giving a little bit more of a buffer there for Weaver. Really at this point, Windrun's really got to stick it to that Weaver. Same with Earthshaker. Earthshaker looks like he already has. He's already popped off one Fissure. They really need to try and bring Weaver's life down just so he's forced to use those consumables. He's got four Tangos, and there's actually still a salve on the Tidehunter. Find the right time to actually attack. Pudge being a lot more defensive. Just shows you that the Witch Doctor's not there anymore. And if Witch Doctor was there, then Pudge would actually be on the front lines like he is right now. I think they're just waiting for like Lacoste to jump in. The Pudge just wants to keep the harassment up and then pop the healing salve off when he needs to. And then we go, salve goes off. Better spend 100 gold and actually get a couple of last hits. Sounds like a bit of an attempted hook. You can hear that globally anywhere on the map, so the second that happens, we just instantly jump ourselves back in towards the mid lane. Thon Mayo throws out the bounce stun just to harass Lacoste back a little bit as well as damage the creep wave a little. And that's all it's really going to do. It's a bit of a standoff on all these lanes. Never really know where the first blood's going to come for this. Could come on the top lane, could come on the bottom lane. I'm expecting it to come on the middle lane with the Pudge initiate. All he needs is a good hook, and we've got two levels on the hook, so his range is actually not too shabby for that. It can be set up there by the Witch Doctor stun. Not exactly what the way he wants to do it, though. Like, if you actually throw out a Witch Doctor stun to help set up the hook, it means you can't actually hold him in place once the hook has actually done its job. Like, your rot will help slow him down, but you've got to keep that bounce stun going as well. Beastmaster has taken a lot of damage on that top lane. 14 for 3 up there, but Prophet at 23 for 3. So as far as the advantage going in that middle lane, it seems to be balanced out. Yeah, a bit of an up and down, but that's only like 300 gold difference. Now it's 100.
Denied.
But 300 gold being the maximum difference in favor of the Radiant. Yeah, that can come from Lacoste. Bit of a weird rot there by Pudge. Walked back up towards the high ground, then started to rot. Possibly thinking that Lacoste might jump that, but Lacoste doesn't really care about that right now. As long as he can stay there, as long as he can farm up, he won't really care. Now Pudge actually having a haste rune inside a bottle. More bottle charges as well as actually having that haste if he gets a little bit too far in over his head. So he can actually be a lot more aggressive now in that bottom lane. In the meantime too, we've got flying in Ring of Health for Lacoste, so he won't give two hoots about what Pudge wants to be aggressive with. All they want to do is like force that haste rune to actually pop for attacking kind of way, just so he has to pop it so he actually has charges in his bottle. Prophet looks like he's level 6. Feel that ulti bouncing around towards that mid. There's also damage down Infinity as well as 1437 a little bit. Gives a Weaver a little bit more room to breathe and power net a little bit more to think about.
Over my dead body.
Not a bad thing. Nice hawk! On Universe, the bounce stun, that's what they need to wait for. There's our first blood. Pudge with the rot, runs back up again, but Prophet comes in. Sprout will now hold Lacoste in place. Pudge will look for a secondary hook, but with a time walk away, Faces Boys a long way away. 1437's here, missing the hook. The haste rune wants to actually run. 1437 lifts up the totem, lands the fissure, but Lacoste is on the wrong side of it. So Pudge will manage to escape first blood with no comeuppance. Apart from Earthshaker, actually getting damaged by the neutrals. And then Pudge also picks up a DD rune as well. Things going beautifully for Crunch in the middle lane. But that's that initiation I was waiting for. It's that hook, as well as the stun. Lich was just a little bit out of position. It's like Infinity's having a hard time on the bottom lane as well. That's just Weaver doing his thing. And Prophet coming at the right time. Unable to actually get the kill. But because his TP is on level 2, didn't take long to get back out towards the top. Actually, it looks like he used a TP scroll to get back. The only upside right now is the fact that Lacoste didn't die. It was just the Lich. Downside is, though, it actually gives more money to Pudge. Which will also now mean there'll be more money coming. Actually, it was Witch Doctor. Actually, Witch Doctor got the last hit. In that case, there better be a Flying Courier. Yeah, there is. Spend that money when you're a support. Pudge, unless you're a little bit of trouble there in the mid, you'll be forced to pop off that DD rune. There goes that Prophet ultimate once again, just a little bit of harassment. Titan Witch want to actually initiate. Lacoste getting hooked in. Pudge not level 6, so he couldn't hold him in place. And with the Smoker to seek currently on the Witch Doctor, they could find an initiation moment if Lacoste comes close enough. Titan wants to go, look for the Gush. There is no Gush yet, and Pudge is not in position for a Hawk. So a wasted smoke in the middle lane by DTS. In the meantime, though, we are still seeing that farm happen on Lacoste. Even though their first blood's gone, just swings the balance of the gold back in favor of the Dire. Pudge looking for... he has the vision, too. He can latch him, but he wants level 6 before he tries this again. He has no charges in his bottle. There goes the Hook, looking for that Lich. Unable to latch it. And now Lacoste comes in, rises the Hook is down. 8-minute rune will now spawn. It's not on the top, it's on the bottom. It's being an illusion rune. So Pudge will start making the walk. It's that third rune in a row now. So Weaver needing a moment, so we'll have ourselves a bit of a pause in the game. So that slow graft coming back up again. So it really is required for the Dire to be massively aggressive on all their lanes. Because Lacoste is getting the farm in the middle lane. They need to make sure they shut down that Windrunner on their bottom lane. And if he can't get farm, we've already got boots as well as a Ring of Basilius. We'll be looking for the mech sometime soon as well. Beastmaster with that Ring of Health means basically most of the harassment of Nature's Prophet's going to end up in nothing. Prophet, however, we should actually notice now TPing down towards the bottom lane. Go look for a kill here on Infinity, and Weaver can do it too, that Weaver wave. Be ready to pop in just a moment. Level 6, so he's actually got 3 on the Shooky, 1 on the Germinator attack, 1 on the Weaver's wave. He didn't just pop that level 6 either. That's only 5 levels. So maybe even a time lapse, so Weaver actually disconnecting from the game. So might just have a couple of moments right now to actually look at these lanes and see how we're actually going. So look back towards our middle lane, so 43 for 12 on Lacoste. Universe in there at 3 for 4, but it's a lot higher because that sacrifice doesn't actually count to your denies. Because that actually is an ability, it's not actually you attacking. That's why it doesn't count to the denies. And we actually have, Cliff and Witch Doctor just running around, but they have no farm whatsoever. Like, it's 2 for 9 and 2 for 1. At least Cliff's actually getting some denies on. And one kill is only on the Witch Doctor. The more important thing is the Pudge at 14 for nil. Massively behind Lacoste in the middle lane. They just have not dominated him down enough. And a kill off a Lich, it's like, meh, it's a Lich. Lacoste is the more powerful one. But on the bright side, they do actually have Priceless on the bottom lane, that being Funnick at 31 for 7. So not too shabby for him, but the Prophet at 39 for 4, looking a little bit better. But just as far as that farm goes, Lacoste at 43 for 12, 35 for 6 on Beastmaster, and then the 17 for 7 on the Windrunner. As far as the farm actually goes, it's, oh wow, hang on. When we actually start, I'm going to just like drop the sounds of the PC game because they've pinged every single where on the map. Everybody is actually pinged on the map. So it's going to make a crap load of noise when it actually happens. I wonder if Casper's actually noticed the same thing. If he hasn't, then his ears are about to get completely blasted. But it's going to be pretty loud, so we'll just keep that very, very low on our restart, which will mean the camera won't move the second after we restart it up. It's interesting to see where we actually head. Like, obviously, we're still waiting for Weaver to actually re-kick back into the game. So yeah, we actually have our couple of moments of just chill time. Just want to watch this Prophet. Really, really want to watch this Prophet. That could actually just be pings on that bottom. Ping myself. Don't don't know how, what type of computer we're actually seeing Funakashi playing on, but he's taking a crap load of time. A crap load of time to actually reboot his computer. Because he then has to reboot Dota 2, then jump back in again, then reconnect back in again. But on the bright side, at least we actually have a reconnect feature. If we didn't, then we wouldn't be able to do this kind of thing, and we would actually find this point being, well, he's got to reboot. I wonder why the reason is he actually has to reboot. Like in Warcraft 3, you just try and stick through it and just go, oh, I got to play through it, man. I can't disconnect. I can't reconnect unless I'm playing on something like RGC. At which point, it wouldn't be too bad. Like, then you just slightly reconnect, so you wouldn't be too bad. We'll just keep waiting for him. I'd like to say there's like all this stuff which I have not talked about, which is just like so massively important. Actually, there is a couple of things I should actually mention. Please definitely head over to the facebook.com/joinDOTA website. You can actually win yourself a monitor over there. It's actually the brand new BenQ monitor, the XL24020T. Definitely a good time to pimp off the sponsor. Without them, this competition would actually not be happening. So big thanks to those guys for putting up the money, but also letting you guys win something as well. All you got to do is just comment and say why you should have the monitor. That simple, guys. It is that simple. Just say, I deserve the monitor because I'm a boss. Or whatever you want to say. So just make a comment, and you'll have a chance of winning. The winner will be randomly drawn out of that, and you will be notified when you actually win. We'll actually tell you on the Facebook page as well. So if you want to like that, just so you actually get the update, awesome for you guys as well. I'm trying to say, how many times am I saying it? Someone should have like an actually counter on the bottom of the screen. It's a really bad habit, man. It's a really bad habit, and I only do it every now and then. And when people point it out, then it keeps happening. But it's only when people point it out that it actually keeps happening. I did that on purpose. I deserve the monitor so I can sell on eBay. That is not a reason, Goat Freak. That is so not a reason. All right, we've now reconnected back into the game, so we're actually going to start in just a moment. There is no countdown for the pause, so it will just start off again. And I'm really, really glad I actually have my game sound now turned off. And there goes the ping. And we can turn it back up again now. Prophet comes down towards that bottom lane. Going for Infinity. There's that power shot. Gets you back out of the sprout. Mace ganking very, very difficult to actually do. In the meantime, I think Lacoste is thinking about that mid lane. He does have his Chronosphere up, so he can actually dive very, very easily there on the Witch Doctor. And if Wishlock is next to a couple, only a couple of his own creeps, the bounce will be pretty effective. Pudge is here, though. Would love to actually hook Lacoste in range of that tower. But doesn't have the angle for it. So it goes back to his farm. He doesn't have the ulti for it either. So he won't want to actually hook him in range of the tower. But just force the ulti off. Prophet ulti bounces around the map as well. Just saying hi. It's a friendly pound the ass. But deals off damage and takes away HP. And just Fazil will bring you down to low HP. spare the people saying, oh, the game is over. It's GG, man. How far are we in? 9 minutes. Oh, it's GG. Yeah, you can never really say it's that. Actually, you can sometimes. Like, oh, what, they won on the draft? Let's start up that conversation again. That was a good conversation to have. The forums just get flamed. In the meantime, Prophet actually with strength treads up. Interesting, it's actually going strength instead of going the Agi, Beastmaster Roar. And then ES will land the Fissure as well, holding in place just long enough to kill him. Prophet trying to TP out, but he's not going to get out there fast enough. With the two stuns, just not enough. And now Pudge comes up towards the top lane. Not level 6 just yet. In fact, actually being slowed by the boar. It's kind of not what he wants. That's not a bad swap up. Makes life a little bit easier. Gives Pudge a little bit more farm so he can actually get towards that urn. Weaver in the meantime, trying to throw off this bottom lane. Runs back past the tower to push Infinity back, realizing Infinity's got no mana left. So it was no threat whatsoever. So they would like to deal a little bit of damage towards this tower. Pudge is now level 6. Oh, misses a hook. A simple latch of a hook gives you so much initiation power. That's why Pudge is becoming a big favored pick. Prophet coming back up towards the top lane. Or actually, no, changing off towards the middle lane. It's like he's just thinking about harassing Lacoste off a little bit. Lacoste jumps it, pops the Chronosphere, ES Fissure will ensure that he gets held in here. Lich Aldi will go as well, and there goes the Prophet. Tried to TP at the last moment. But obviously on cooldown means he can't do anything. Actually, that's what he did. He popped the ultimate as the last thing. Realizing he's going to die. Beastmaster also gets a kill on the Pudge on the top lane. Looks like a simple axe as well as greater boar. It makes it a lot more difficult to actually play back in towards the middle. Akos actually being harassed down here by Tidehunter. He is not level 6. If he had that Ravage, it would have been, well, a double kill there in that middle lane. But unable to actually get it. Wish Doctor also not level 6. There's no ultimate for him. Universe TP is out. He's had enough of that middle lane. Might see Wish Doctor as well as Titus try and stay here in the middle lane. Just a little bit longer to pop up. How are we looking for Weaver? Weaver with a ring of health. Also still with 1800 gold, so we can actually complete up that Vanguard at this point. But I don't think he'll want to. I think at this point, Weaver's going to see if he can actually get as close as he can to a sacred relic. Get towards that Radiance if he can get it early on. Then life can be looking pretty good. The Ring of Health lets him live there on that bottom lane. No, he is going to go to the Vanguard. Infinity now. Let's get harassed and pushed back. Weaver blocking him as well. Prophet wants to TP in. Infinity's already popped off wind runs, and now they're going to go look for the Sprout, holding them together. Weaver Wave will come in. That should actually help out Prophet a little bit, because he's taking the tower right now. He's got to get away from that tower while they get the kill on Windrunner. Beastmaster's coming in. Simple Axe. Prophet goes down again. Third time he's died, but does actually help get the kill on the bottom lane. Weaver's just got to be a little bit cautious himself. He has those Treants there, which will help out for the moment. Earthshaker actually getting killed off here. Actually getting a kill, sorry, on the Witch Doctor. And Weaver wants to have a go. Shuki's away, but he has no mana left. Running away. There's no mana for another Shuki. This is a little bit worse. And Vasus Void going down the middle lane in the meantime. Weaver getting fissured in. And destroyed. But Vasus Void going down the mid. What is with these kills going off in completely different points? Wishel's like, yeah, I'll come and I'll help out. That's a smart plan. Radiant's top tower is under and then walks into three enemy heroes. Fudge now with yet another rune, propped up on the top lane. It's going to get slowed down a little bit. Those Treants are level 4 now, so they do tank up that power shot a hell of a lot. TP support going to come in, so Windrunner looking for a good shackle. Needs a good line for it, and that's why she's trying to run out west or east, but she couldn't get it. It was nicely actually played up there by the Prophet, making sure he stayed in the middle of the lane. And a fantastic Sprout. Lich Ulti will go. It won't be enough to kill, but Windrunner with that last attack will be enough. Calculated and down to the very, very last hit there of Infinity. And Prophet for the fourth time, or fifth time now, died fourth time. There's still one kill for the Weaver, one death for the Weaver as well. And just assists everywhere. It's the four kills on PowerNet, the Beastmaster. I'm worried about what he's going to buy. Vanguard's already done for him. Vanguard, Bracer, Strength, Treads are 13 minutes in. Can even afford to have two TPs. So go down towards the bottom lane, and then also, in about 1 minute's time, go and help out a friend in need. Check it out, we've actually gone. So the raid, actually just a little bit ahead. Pudge, looking for a hawk. Cool, of course, if he ran down a little bit further south, he would have been gone. Didn't in the end. In the meantime, top lane, Prophet TP's up towards the top. Holds Windrunner in place, but she does get herself out with a very, 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 very fast power shot. But does get brought down by Nature's Prophet's ultimate. Universe is also here. Weaver taking a lot of damage, but just time-lapses out of the damage. So support being here, and then in comes our 1437. Not a good place to be, but it's a great fissure to actually land. The Weaver wave will let them dive this out pretty easily. Is there close enough for an anchor smash? No, he's not. And Prophet sprouts on cooldown. Weaver wave is still attached to him, and the gush will be enough. Gets the kill in the meantime. Weaver's taking a lot of damage, but he does get back past that tower. Now TP coming in towards the middle lane. They want to go for Lacoste. And Prophet gets a sprout, then they can actually time off the hook. Spotting out the Hawk. The Hawk does go invisible, but the fade time is just a little bit too much, so he does get brought down there by the Treants. Treants spotting out a couple of friends. Pudge can get himself a nice hook, but in the meantime, actually Beastmaster hooking actually the Witch Doctor out of the Beastmaster's Roar. The Sprout going off, holding Infinity there, but the Power Shot goes straight over the top for Chronosphere. It's a perfect position, right on top of the Witch Doctor. He's going to find the right Pudge. He does find the right Pudge, and he does not actually deny himself as well. In the meantime, though, tower's getting killed off. In fact, Lich actually getting the deny on that top tower, so Universe not denying off the Weaver. Blood being spilled in all lanes. With that tower going down, that Radiant Grub's going to drop down a little bit further. That's 1,000 gold going the way of the Dire, but there's still blood being spilled of the Dire. Weaver kind of wants to go here on Universe. Gets the Shuki damage to start with. Doesn't have enough mana for a time lapse, but she has Prophet here. Lich Ollie won't actually bounce. It wasn't close enough to Weaver. The Prophet gets the kill and revenge. Staying aggressive, wanting to keep this push going in the lanes. The dust will wear off in just a moment, so Weaver can shooky himself again. But he's very, very low on mana and life. So might be forced back, but that Vanguard up on him will give him his life back again. Ring of Basilius will slowly regenerate that mana. The Hawk watching. I think Thon Mayo saw it for a second. But he can't get close enough to it. They see the Urn Charge up for Pudge now. Tidehunter is also in support, so just Dick, Bracer, Boots. Probably going to be looking to actually complete up some Arcanes on him. Invisibility. Just to ensure that he can give that back to Pudge as well. Pudge wouldn't mind the Arcane effects, but with the bottle there. Well, hello, Hawk. Spots them moving down. 1437 really needs to get out of here. The Invis is already up. 1437 gets gushed. Rot, ulti, holds Earthshaker in place. Doesn't have time to land down a Fissure, but Beastmaster will come in. Roar on the Pudge. Time Warp goes in. The good Ravage. The Vanguard. The freaking Maledict. Also popping off from Lacoste. Doesn't want to take too much damage. Clip. Prophet comes in from behind. Actually holding Palnet inside the Sprout. But then Kranich wants to pull him in. There's no bounce done. And Kranich is being slowed down, but he's also slowing Palnet. Doesn't get the deny. The Axes get the kill. Held onto it beautifully. Tidehunter also being dived to the T1 tower. Prophet wants to come back in again. Try and get this kill here on Beastmaster. But Universe is slowing him down the top. The Wish Doctor actually gets the last hit there on PowerNet. Bouncing stun there from the Prophet. Not going to be enough. A bouncing ultimate there from Prophet. Not going to be enough. And they lose off 4-1. I think Lacoste also got a couple during that. Yeah, 3-1. PowerNet was 6-1. Even though he was the only one who actually dies, his first time he actually died as well. And Wish Doctor got that one, so extra money for him. But they're going to lose a tier 1 tower as well. That is not a decent trade. Fortification. Just trying to make it a little bit harder for them to actually get the last hit in the tower with the creep wave there. And it does work as well. So the gold is split and not given to Lacoste. Lacoste going very, very defensive. Perseverance probably... I don't know why I was thinking Lincoln's. TP coming out towards the top lane. Weaver running himself away. 2500 gold for the Weavers. The Weavers actually having a pretty good time. I think he's actually died as well. No, it's 2-1. 2-1 for the Weaver, 70-8. It's at 90 and 3-1 on Lacoste, though. That's going to be the damaging thing. So, initial stun. So, Weaver just shookies himself through. Damages and then just runs back. That's all he really needs to do. Doesn't want to get too close. Smoker Deceit looking for another gank. Able to walk past the walls, but there's no walls there for the Radiant. And a very, very quick TP out there by the Earthshaker. Was the Earthshaker? It was actually a boy in orange. It was actually the Lich. Prophet here in the middle lane, taking some of the trees to make him his own. And now Pudge will look for a good hook. Yeah, she has the vision here on PowerNet, but just needs to land that ultimate. If he can get it on Windrun, he'll prefer that. Power shot now, challenge misses! And Earthshaker demolishes them with a big ultimate. Crash held in range of the tower. Ultimate actually, nice ultimate there by Wish Doctor. Will kill off 1437, and possible bring down PowerNet as well. Gush is trying to hold him in place a little bit longer. Look for the hook. The hook this time latches on. Lich ultimate! Split! Oh! It's still enough to kill off the Pudge. It's not enough to kill off the Tidehunter. But a revenge kill from the Lich. Cosman ultimate was well worth it to kill off that Pudge before he can spend more of his money. And then plants the ward up on the high ground so they can see where the Pudge is going to be hooking from. With Lacoste being there. But a very, very big fail initiation there by Pudge. They still turned it around, making it a 3-2 trade, which wasn't too bad in the end. And with that Beastmaster going down again, that does push him back a little bit further, so Necromicon block will be pushed back a little bit more. Warriors of the wood. Radiant structures are fortified. Tier 1 tower will definitely go down, but a bit of a waste of fortification. Actually, maybe not double TP. ES going to start with the initial stun. Infinity needs to actually shackle him. It's in a good position to do so. Void jumps in, there's that shackle, hold him in place, and Prophet, very suicidal. A tier 1 tower for his life. In a way, yeah, that's worth it. In a way, it's definitely not, because they're throwing more kills the way. They've worked very, very hard to try and bring these kills back again. And Weaver's been working hard to keep up with the farm. You keep on throwing him lives. Sure, you get an extra 200 gold from the tower. But, yeah, Pudge looking for a hook. Oh, the boar. Pound that, just be like, what hook? What? Ah, a hook. Pudge with that haste rune, running back in towards the middle lane, looking for another one. Infinity. Out of position for the hook, so Crash just throwing out random ones, gets power shotted, then also gets frosted, then gets fissured. Still a lot of damage being done, but that flesh heap's giving a little bit more to live through. Gush as well as 2000 HP, you gotta bring off that Pudge, that's a lot of life. Now the Sprout will come in, Weaver wave as well, but it's a great, fantastic ultimate here from Lacoste. He's attacking on Weaver, first Ashley killing up the Wish Doctor in the back end of play, and then a great as well Shackle Shot, holding Prophet as well as Weaver in. Pudge will take a fall as well. Lacoste just backtracking everything, leads himself through. Triple kill, going to look for the Ultra, they want to give it to him as well, but Windrun just says, you know what, screw it man, I'm going to take this. Four heroes down for the Dire, Tynum's the only one to live. And he actually TPs himself away. He ran back up towards the Radiant side of the river after popping off his Ravage. But that was an amazing ulti there from Lacoste, and then an even better Shackle Shot from Infinity to keep that going. The Wish Doctor was actually just dying. He was attacking the Weaver, and that's all he wanted to do. But it was actually the cleave damage, and I keep on saying freaking it again. It was the cleave damage of the Battle Fury which allowed Lacoste to bring down the Witch Doctor. See, my brain does tick when it happens a lot. Sometimes it just takes a little bit longer. Lacoste flying out right now. What have you actually got for him? Mask of Madness is now completed as well. 22 minutes in. Looking good for the farm of Lacoste. And the gold graph will actually... yeah, it's a big spike up. Heading on its way towards the 4,000 gold advantage. Not only was it the time to actually farm in the middle lane. Did it again. Time to farm in the middle lane. Damn! Yeah, but not only the time to actually get those kills in the middle as well as the tower, but it's the time to farm in the other lanes. Wish Dr. Warrior to come on down. The wise thing is actually retreating back again. Weaver's got to be really, really careful. Smoke gank. They have enough damage. Beastmaster Roar, Necromicon units as well. There goes the Roar. The Chotty will bounce. It's a lot of damage. Very, very fast with the ES ultimate. Three ultimates being used to kill off the Weaver. That's worth it in the end. You almost had enough to buy up that Sacred Relic, but what's not going to be worth it? Tier 1 tower, it's going to be the trade. So Tier 1 tower in the mid goes down. Top Tier 1 tower on the top. That should actually stay alive for the moment. Fortification if they need it. But Lacoste is on that bottom lane. He's pushing that out by himself. Pudge is looking for a hook. The ping actually going out here from Easy. They know Pudge is on the hunt. He gets a Tier 1 tower on the top lane, so they don't end up actually holding it. Dire's top tower has fallen. TP now coming in, Lacoste is here, Pudge's got to look for the hook, Lacoste pops the ultimate, Pudge needs to get Lacoste out of there, saves it, no he doesn't. Windrunner with a power shot does a pretty, pretty nice job, but it's actually already using the time walk and good Ravage off there by the Titan and finishes off the Faceless Void. This could be their fight right now, if Pudge can land himself another hook, there goes our hook. Lanches in, Power Net with no ultimate up just yet, 10 seconds before he has that back again. Titan's taking a lot of damage, Power Net's just sitting there on the front lines, but Infinity gets himself basically two kills right now. And Pudge also fissure, Earthshaker finishes him off. Just not enough stayability, he was popping off his bottle charges all through that as well as his earned charges to keep himself alive. But it just was not enough. It's enough mana for a Necro Book, yeah, Necro Book level 2 recipe will fly out. That mech for the Windrunner gave them everything they needed, the power shot as well to make sure they can bring down very, very fast. But the Weaver also missing from that fight. And he keeps missing from a lot of fights as well. He's just not there, he's just farming up on that top lane. He's got ganked because of it. Now they're going to possibly lose the Tier 2 tower. Prophet Ultimate makes life a little bit more difficult for them though. Pushing out all the waves again, but Infinity with that DD rune. Farmed on the bottom lane. Let's actually see a 4-star actually coming out from a Windrunner today. It's one thing we've always been lacking from all the Windrunners that have played today. Going straight for that sheep stick. They'll have to go in the mech first. There's no big positional play, they just do it themselves. Infinity has enough money to get there. It probably just wants to get up towards that Mystic Staff, or at least the Ultimate Orb. Has enough for the Ultimate Orb, in fact. And that's probably what she's going to go back towards the main base to actually buy. Nope, 4-star! Yay! Well done, Infinity! I love you, man! I love you! Gave me my 4-star! Not a bad thing as well if you get a Chronosphere and someone's just slightly out of it. Prophet in the meantime. Looks like he's going to go for an Aghanim Scepter. Basically, he has it now too. So he'll go back to his main base and buy that up. There he goes, our Aghanims. Lacoste looks like he's actually with an Ogre Club, looking for a BKB. Going to make him impossible to stop when it comes to these team fights. No amount of hexing, no amount of stuns, no Pudge ultimate. They can't pull him out of that fight. They'll have to deal with him. And now Weaver, really bad place to be. Dust will pop off. Beastmaster Roar as well. They really need some vision around here. There's no wards hanging anywhere. And now Pudge picks up the invis and might be looking for somebody to kill. Beastmaster's still here. Mana boots, so he's actually keeping tabs on them all. Prophet, Void jumping down, wants to kill the Witch Doctor. Bounce Stunner going up pretty nicely. Good. Actually, fantastic Maledict there on Universe. Now he's going to pop off the ultimate. Universe will actually die. The Lich Ulti bounce in between the Witch Doctor and the Pudge. Oh, Universe won't die. Ravish tries to pop off here from Cliff to try and slow down Lacoste, but Lacoste already dealing enough damage. Three down, four down. Prophet retreating. Lich gets himself a double kill. It's a great Lich ultimate. Once he realized the Witch Doctor wasn't going to move, and the bounce stun actually had it as he stopped having its effect. That was it. But once again, that Pudge hook goes astray. Trying to get those initiations off right. It's just not working for him. There's that Mithril Hammer. Lacoste almost with that BKB. Prophet still trying to push out these lanes. That's one big thing that is actually going the right way for the Dire, is the fact that Prophet is able to push out wherever he wants to go to. Keep that ultimate bouncing around the map. Keep those lanes pushed if there is an opening. And that's one thing easy to be really careful about. Hold on to those TP scrolls and make sure you can jump back when you need to. Because Prophet will push down a tower when you're not looking. And if you don't get yourself a good trade, then it is possible for DTS to get themselves back into this game. But it will be, yeah, just slowly spiking back up again. Just over about 8k gold now. Even our CS, 180 for 33 on Lacoste. 727. And then the 6-2, 11, 112 for Powernep. Hasn't really got any more kills in recent times. He's been more of that supporter role. That's why he's up to 11 assists. Wants to get it onto Lacoste. Infinity also, he's been the ones getting with those power shots. Which with that double kill, doubles his amount of kills he's got. A 12 assists for him. Always there for the Frost. The mid lane looking for initiation there on the Pudge. Wow, what power net we get for a Blink Dagger. He's got Necromicon level 3. And that's mainly for the Weaver. There's nowhere for the Weaver to hide once he gets that Necro Book. And he can send those Necro Book units as well as the Boar on for a little bit of a run. He can kill off all those crows. Kill off all those wards. I don't know if they can crow. I just saw the crow up here. Monkey say, monkey see. Looking for a gank. Crow will fly out. Getting killed off by the Prophet Ultimate. Probably not exactly what they planned, but the tier 2 tower is what they planned for, really. Faceless Void actually has that BKB up too. That's what's flying out. Mithril Hammer. Yep, BKB. Immune to the spells. The more you pop it off, though, the smaller duration. Prophet now goes in towards the mids. They realize the tier 2 is going to be pushed on the bottom lane. They want to get some form of revenge. And the mid tower looks like the one they want. So Pudge will come down. Rock the creep wave to help it down, but the fortification for the Dire. TP support will come very, very fast back to the tier 2 tower. Oh no, they're going to go. They're going to go into the base. The defense core goes, the Axis will fly one to damage off the creep wave, but the creep wave has actually been split. Beastmaster keeping view there on the Pudge. And because of that, Powernet kept the creep wave in between him. There's no defense, they've already used their fortification right now. Prophet Ultimate will bounce around. Wants to come back down towards this bottom. Hawk actually does land this time on Powernet, but he does not combo it with an ultimate. Now the Ravage will go from Cliff. He's already down to half HP. Lacoste pops off the BKB. He goes from one. He goes to second. Lichotti will bounce back up towards the Prophet. The ultimate there from the Faceless Void, holding the Wish Doctor in place. Two hits to actually kill him. Give him a double kill. Bottom ranks will go. Weaver comes in. He has completed up that Mock of Brilliance. I should be able to kill off 1437 right now. The Mech Charge just cancels it off. The Roar goes off. Weaver is gone. This is rape. Prophet goes towards the top lane, but Cliff is calling the GG. With the bottom barracks gone, Prophet can't kill up that top fast enough. Double TP is going to come in. The Weaver as well as Tidehunter have already disconnected. Prophet will go down. He's shackled to his own sprout. And Lacoste will just bash the living crap out of him. But the hero is disconnecting. They need all of him to disconnect. There goes our Witch Doctor. And that'll be the GG call. 33-15 is where we're going to end this first game. Easy with a fantastic start off. Pudge looking for the hook. It's one of the only ones left with Prophet. It's only the two of them. And there we go. So Pudge actually disconnects. GG call. And it's just Prophet who actually has to leave as well. I think he's just sitting there. Yeah, I said Crow. I know. I know I said it. It's not. It is. Chronosphere. All right, so that is going to be our GG, Prophet. What are you doing? It's still in the game, man. All right, we're going to call that our GG officially from us. So we'll be heading in towards game number two right now. And it will be same teams, actually. Exactly same teams, funny enough. So easy going up against DTS. DTS need to win their next game or else they are out of the BenQ tournament. So winner takes all. There is no prize for second place. And Easy looking in a very good position to actually have our grand final matchup of Easy versus Monkey. They were both in the same groups. Easy have actually faced off against Monkey before and obviously took it. There we went 3-0 in their bracket. So we'll be back here in just a moment with game number two here of our second semi-final.